So thanks for joining this webinar. The objective of this webinar is to try to give you a feel of what SAFe framework is all about. My name is Anand, and I am the founder director of a company called Agile Spirit Private Limited. And I'm also partnering with a Netherlands-based company called Gladwell Academy, which involves in training, and Blinklane Consulting, which involves in Agile transformation services. So with your permission, let me get started. So first of all, I'd like to say a little bit about myself. Who am I? 21 years of IT experience. First Asian who is currently residing in Asia to be certified as SPCT from Scaled Agile. I've provided training to close to 1,200 participants in SAFe across India, Europe and Brazil. I've also trained 120 participants in SAFe in India and Europe. I also did my first RTE class in Denmark a couple of weeks back. A little bit about my experience. I have experience in Agile coaching and enterprise transformation since 2009, using SAFe, Scrum, XP, Lean and Kanban practices. Currently, I am playing the role of an enterprise Agile coach at Philips. I've been here since the last 4 years now. I've launched about 10 Agile release trains, close to 100 to 120 people in each train. A little bit of expertise in coaching enterprise agility. I really don't call myself as a great experience because every day there is something new to learn. I also have experience in coaching team level leadership even at the enterprise level. I've also worked with multiple teams across the globe in this coaching experience. So first of all, let's try to understand the agenda of the webinar. So these are the six items that I would like to share a little bit more details now. First of all, what's enterprise agility and why is it important today? What's agility and what's enterprise agility? We'll start from there. And how does SAFe enable enterprise agility? How do we get built-in quality, alignment, program execution and transparency in SAFe way of working? What is the role of leadership in SAFe transformation? I would also like to talk a little bit about SAFe and DevOps. A webinar is not enough to learn about DevOps. Probably a lifetime is required. So I'll try my best to give you a feel of how SAFe and DevOps work together. And the last topic that I would like to talk is about, is something related to implementing SAFe and what are the challenges that we have in the implementation part of it. So first question is, what is the challenge for today? What are the challenges that most of our IT organizations and businesses are facing? First is complexity. We have built systems, we kept on adding new functionalities to the existing systems, and finally we have ended up with a system like what's shown in the picture. It's a completely chaotic and a complex system is what we have built. If you touch at one place, there are 100 different things gets affected. It's something like a human body what we have created. The second challenge that we face today is customers do not know what they want. When the whole Agile movement started, or when the IT movement started back in 80s, it was very simple. You had the business sitting, you had a couple of developers sitting next to each other. The developers would develop something, ask the business folks who are actually doing manual work in those days to verify. There used to be a quick feedback, and they were actually doing the Agile way of working during early 80s. Then what happened? The work started moving to a different location, and also we started building complex systems. So naturally what happened, in order to bridge these gaps, we created something called a system requirement document or a system requirement specifications documents. We created this document so that people across the globe can understand the same language. And now we have completed that era. We have completed an era where we knew what the customer want. We are now entering into a system where we really don't know what the customer want, and the customers themselves do not know what they want. So going back to the old way of working, freezing the requirements and then trying to do is a recipe for disaster. It's not possible. I'm not saying waterfall is a bad way of working. What I'm saying is waterfall is not the framework in today's model. To give you a simple example of what customers do not know, take any customer, ask them what kind of feature do you need on your mobile phone. You will never get a definitive answer. If there is some definitive answer, that means the feature already exists in the system. The third challenge we face is the frequency of changes. The market dynamics, technology changes, and there is enormous amount of changes that's happening across the globe. Once upon a time, early 80s, the software that we were trying to build was supposed to cater only to one region. Predominantly, it was the United States and Europe. Over a period of time, the whole globe has become one country now. Now, you can sit in any country and start thinking about the requirements of the country, of the people in different country. And now that's creating a huge challenge because there is a lot of cultural changes. There is a lot of changes that happen across the globe, and you really cannot understand the real requirements of the customer. When you start developing these kind of systems and when you engage with your customers, you get a lot of feedback. Hence, frequency of these changes have gone very high. Once upon a time, we had only a few competitors. In fact, there were many businesses who didn't even have competitors. Nokia is an example. Once upon a time, there was nobody to beat Nokia. But today, there is no Nokia in the world. We just have Nokia. Nokia mobile phones have gone, but Nokia still exists in the form of various other telecommunication products. Since you have many competitors, your time to market is very important. I remember developing a product in my HP days where we did a fantastic work to develop a product, but unfortunately, it was the form factor of the product was not viable to today's market. People had already started using iPads and we are developing something on a desktop version. We were way behind the market. So time to market is very critical. And if you do not capture the market, there is somebody, your so-called competitor, to create the market. And the biggest challenge is you don't know who is your competitor. For example, when the September 11th attacks happened, the entire airline industry was stopped. And can someone make a guess who was the competitor for the airline industry? You don't know where your competitor is born. You don't know when your competitor is born. The competitor for the airline industry was none other than HP and Cisco. Cisco created something called telepresence and HP created something called as the Halo technology, with the help of which you could literally see people as if they were sitting in front of you. And essentially, you don't need to travel. So honestly speaking, you don't know where your competitor is born, and hence time to market is very critical. No doubt about quality. Quality is the ultimate stuff that people look for. And quality means what? You buy a product, the product never dies. That's what is quality according to me. The real quality of the product is known only when you forget the price of what you purchased. That's what is quality. The other biggest soft challenge that most of the organizations ignore is people motivation. Honestly speaking, human beings are very different creatures. And the kind of work what we're doing, many organizations and enterprises do not know how to motivate people. So constantly motivating people and so that they build fantastic products is another big challenge. And needless to say, the technology changes are so rapid. What was the hot technology today, 6 months down the line, doesn't exist. 3 years back, we heard about service-oriented architecture. Everybody were talking about SOA. Today, SOA is gone. We've got microservices. So technology changes also contribute a lot to today's challenge. So what's SAFe all about? What do you mean by SAFe? So SAFe is the world's leading framework for enterprise agility. We've not come here to build a small pen or a small pencil. We want to build large systems in an agile way. We have come here to build complex systems in an agile way. So SAFe is a freely available knowledge base of proven integrated principles and practices for lean, agile and DevOps. So SAFe is free. You want to use SAFe in your enterprise, you don't have to pay anything, anybody. You can just use it. It's a open source. And it's a knowledge base of proven integrated principles and practices. It's not somebody got a dream, they wrote a framework. the folks from Scaled Agile have been using this way back, I would say, so way back from 2007-2008. And they've done multiple experiments in the market to really understand if this works. Only when they were convinced, only when the fact patterns dictated that things actually work in SAFe, that's when the SAFe version 1.0 came. And people like you and me who start using FACE start giving constant feedback to SAFe. And hence, it's evolved from 1.0 to 4.5 over a period of close to now about 7 years. And these principles and practices are for Lean, Agile, and DevOps. So DevOps is a new entry that has come into the definition of what is SAFe. So this is the picture of the Scaled Agile framework. This is version 4.5. And quite a few of you would get panic when you look at the framework. To be honest, the framework is very simple. To really understand what the framework is, you'll have to attend a class from some of the industry experts who can really teach you what SAFe is in a very simple terms. And then you'll start falling in love with the framework. Essentially, if you see, it synchronizes alignment, collaboration, and it helps delivery of large number of teams. You're trying to build an aircraft, a complex system like an aircraft or a complex system like cyber systems. It's not possible to build with small co-located teams. It's humanly impossible. If you try to do that, it will take probably a few years to complete it, or even half a decade probably to complete it. So you will have to build these systems pretty fast with good quality and make sure that we deliver value. What I mean by deliver value is customers would love to use our products. If you really want to do that, then scaling horizontally is mandatory. You can't have teams sitting in one place of geography. You will have to have teams spread across horizontally across multiple geographies. Now, when you spread across multiple geographies, there is a need to also scale the framework up to portfolio. It cannot happen that at the top, people still are with waterfall mindset. At the bottom, teams are doing SAFe. It is not an equation that's going to balance, and this balance will, and if you try to execute this equation, the enterprise is just going to burn off things. You will not be able to deliver anything meaningful if you do not have your entire organization learn and do the real SAFe. So these are the four important, the pillars that SAFe always looks for. These are called the core values of SAFe. First is built-in quality. We will look into all these four core values in a little more detail. But to give you a picture, this is SAFe. And I would like to draw attention at the bottom of the picture, which is kind of gray colored. If you see here, Lean Agile leaders are the foundation of the framework. Your leadership team in your enterprise are the foundation. We have a set of core values that we always believe in and we always respect for. There's something called as a Lean Agile mindset. Now, if you don't know what is mindset, it's very simple. We all know who was Aristotle. Aristotle was one of the greatest philosophers of the world. And sometime back, Aristotle during his life made one stupid statement, and he said that the number of teeth in women's mouth is less than the number of teeth in the men's mouth. And for 200 years, this was what believed as the truth. When the small boy came forward and asked the world's most stupid question, and he said, "Can I count?" This is what is called mindset. Somebody at the top, somebody learned person talks something, and then that becomes a kind of a lamented, like a cemented decisions. That is not what we talk here. We talk about lean mindset where there is respect for people. We focus on flow. We focus on innovation. We focus on improvement. Whereas we always make sure that we deliver customer value. And the whole of SAFe is built on set of principles on product development flow. Amazing set of principles from Don Reinerston. And there's something called implementation roadmap, which I'm going to talk at the end. I want to draw your attention to the last part of this gray colored panel at the bottom, which is called SPC. SPC stands for SAFe Program Consultant. And SPCs are the change agents for a safe enterprise. They play a critical and a very, very important role in making sure that the whole organization embraces safe. So these are the key people who make safe transformation possible and a big success in the organization. Let's look at a little bit about more details here. Now, this is what is called the full view of safe. We call this as the full configuration of safe. At the bottom, you have the team levels. They are Scrum teams. They could be hardware team, software team, or firmware team. They are exactly doing Scrum. So the whole of safe is built on Scrum. Scrum is the foundational element of how we do iterative incremental development. In safe, an iteration is fixed for 2 weeks, not 1 week, not 3 weeks, not 4 weeks, not beyond 4 weeks, of course. It's fixed for 2 weeks. And there are scientific reasons of why we are fixed for 2 weeks, which you generally get to know when you attend a leading safe or an implementing safe class. The heartbeat of an agile enterprise or a safe enterprise is something called PI planning. PI planning is a mega event that happens probably once in a quarter, where all of us come together, plan the work for one quarter, understand dependencies, solve dependencies, come together, plan, and then go back, identify the risks, and then go back and start executing to deliver value. There's a program layer above the team layer, where you can see a small icon like a train here. It's called Agile Release Train. The whole group of the program and team together is called as an ART, an Agile Release Train. And this Agile Release Train consists of all the teams and also a few key important roles in the program layer. Together, they form a train. Slightly above is called as the large solution layer, where if you have to build large cyber security systems, you really cannot build with one team, two teams, three teams. Probably you'll have to build something like about 25 teams. And when you have 25 teams, you can't have all 25 teams in one team, in one train. It's not possible. Scientifically, it's been proved that beyond 125 people, the coordination and communication becomes extremely complex. So we restrict the number of people in a train to say something like 125 to maximum of 150. And then we create one more layer called as a solution layer, where we coordinate work across teams. If all of us have to come together to build a huge, say, an X-ray mission, an MR mission, or a huge aircraft, or a huge jet, or something very, very security systems if you want to build, we use this layer. And finally, at the top is the portfolio layer, where strategic decisions are being made. So if you can see the way how it's been structured, everybody in the organization who needs to work are a part of the system. And the biggest challenge is there is no word called manager here. It doesn't mean that there are no managers required. Managers are required in the system. They will have to play a different role. Unlike the conventional manager, they become probably an RTE, enable teams to execute. So this is the fundamental aspect of this whole safe enterprise. Let me move to the next topic. So I would like to spend a little time to understand, to help you understand about what is core values. If you do not understand these core values, we really cannot make sense of what the framework is all about. The first core value is called as built-in quality. The second one is called transparency. The third one is program execution. And fourth one is the alignment. Let me take you through each one of them a little more in detail. So what is built-in quality? Back in 1950, Sir Edward Deming made a beautiful statement where he said, cease dependence on mass inspection to achieve quality. Improve the process, build the quality into the product in the first place. Deming started seeing the way how some of the auto giant companies in US were trying to build systems. And what they were doing is, at the end, they were trying to test quality. But if something goes wrong at the end, it's going to be a huge cost of change to go rework and then fix the problem. So Deming made a statement saying that quality is not something you need to test at the end. Quality is something that you need to build within your product. That's exactly what Toyota does today when they build their products. They have something called as an add-on card. A card which can be pulled by anybody in the production line. And if the cord is pulled, the production lines comes to a complete halt, which means nobody is going to work till the cord is released. Now, this is called built-in quality. Why? If something goes wrong and let's say somebody is trying to fit the lights, headlight into your car, and for some reason a panel in your headlight is slightly oversized, the panel doesn't fit in. So this guy pulls the cord and stops the whole production line. There are many other people who can still work, but nobody will work. Everybody comes to this guy and asks, why did you pull the cord? This guy says, this is the problem. All of them come, discuss, understand how to fix the problem, and try, and everybody helps to fix the problem. In short, interactions and individuals or process and tools is what is being exhibited here. And make a guess, guys, how many times this cord is going to get pulled in a day in a product, in a typical Toyota production plant line? It's close to something like 3,000 to 4,000 times it gets pulled. That means to say that quality is built at every point. Defects are not allowed to escape. Now, this is the same stuff what we have in continuous integration. I hope you've heard about something called as the green build policy. If the build fails, nobody checks in the code. Everybody stops checking in the code. That is the same principles of what we have done here. So in order to have this kind of quality, built-in quality in place, every iteration calls for unit testing. There has to be enormous amount of unit testing to be done. There are functional testing to check if the feature as a function is working as expected. And there is system testing where we think about use cases and try to see how value flows across various features to deliver something meaningful experience to the customers. And finally, there is regression testing where we do multiple rounds of regression testing to make sure that we don't create new defects just because we are trying to develop new functionality. It's not just about testing, even about evaluation of the work what we have done is objective. It's not subjective, meaning to say that nobody would look at a PPT or a weekly status report and say, yes, the story is completed. No, it has to have passed through something called a team demo. A team demo is a demo given by the team, or you call it as a sprint review or an iteration review meeting where you give a demo of work what you've done. It's the real time working software which is getting demoed. The next important part is the system demo. There are 10 teams working on 10 different things, and all the 10 cannot be completed in one shot. So the work is being split, but we have to integrate it early. The sooner you integrate, the better is the outcome, the better is the learning, the better is the feedback, the quicker is the feedback. So system demo is a very critical element. There's something called PI system demo that happens at the end of every PI, where the whole work that's been planned for the PI is being demoed to the business stakeholders. And finally, there is a solution demo. If there are capabilities being developed, we give a solution demo. So everything is objective, nothing is subjective here. The next one is called as program execution. If you see, the whole world loves the concept of divide and rule, divide and execute. Even in our organizations, we have divided the organizations into development. Within development, we have various competencies. We have Java development groups, we have .NET development groups, we have blockchain development groups. If you see, the picture at the top represents the various vertical organizations that have. Each member in the vertical organizations have their own goal. And when you try to pull all of them and give them a goal, it doesn't work because each one of them are working in a different direction. But what Agile Release Train does is we pick a mix of all people required to deliver value, and they have one goal, which is deliver customer value. Now suddenly your execution becomes a totally different paradigm because all of them are now focused to one thing. People who were cooperating before will now start collaborating with each other. So that's the beauty of a concept of a train where all of them have a single focus and they all march together to meet a common vision, which is customer satisfaction or building solutions that matter to our customers. There's something called alignment. There's a concept where if the IT and the business do not align with each other, then we are actually developing a disaster, or that's a recipe for a disaster. And generally what happens is, in the waterfall model, at the end of your development phase, when there is testing that happens, or something called UAT, what we were calling as user acceptance test, that's when we realize that there was a big problem in the way how we have developed the system. To prevent this, SAFe has a wonderful way of how to develop alignment. Let me go back to the main picture here to give you a feel of what alignment is. You have portfolio at the top. You have something called epics. They are large initiatives that could probably run for multiple PIs. PI is a program increment, which is about 4 to 5 iterations. Each iteration is 2 weeks. These epics are broken up into capabilities. Each capability is broken into feature, and each feature is broken into story. There is a perfect alignment between what strategy the business wants to achieve and what the IT teams at the bottom are trying to develop. There is a perfect alignment, and the concept of demos reinforces this alignment to make sure that we are doing the right things. So let me go back to my page here. So your portfolio epics are broken to capabilities. Capabilities are broken to features. Features are broken to stories. There is an alignment between what I need at the top to what is being developed at the bottom, which means to say that the value delivery really happens from the bottom, where teams develop stories, deploy stories, the business validates them, releases to the end users, and the end user starts using it, provide feedback. There is again inputs that are coming in. So there is a constant loop of engagement with customers and your business teams and your management, which means to say that we are all working in a perfect alignment, which eventually leads to a lot of cost savings, a lot of cost savings. We really do not know how much money we spend in doing this conference call when something goes wrong in production. We have no clue about it, but every minute we talk on the phone actually is being billed to somebody somewhere. The last and the most important thing is transparency. Look at this picture. No matter whether you take a photograph of a dog, everybody needs a feedback. Everybody wants to see how things look at. This is exactly what I mean by transparency. The work done by the team at the bottommost layer gets reflected at the top as a part of your demos. You demo them. Everybody knows what's happening. There is no surprises. Trust enables transparency. So the leader's job here is to enable trust. The teams will become transparent. Now, PI planning is an example of creating transparency, where the business says, this is exactly what we want, guys. Please come help us. Let's work together as a team. And then it creates a short horizon planning. Portfolio Kanban. Everybody who joins the organization at the lowest level as a fresh engineer gets access to the portfolio Kanban, which means they can go and look at what are the strategic initiatives taken by the organization. Trains, we make the output of the trains visible. We make the program backlog visible. At any point of time, the teams know what's coming next. I&A events, the inspect adapt events, will ask for transparency, where we come, meet, try to solve problems, become vulnerable to challenges, and then solve challenges. As I've told you, system demo is by far the most important demo, where we evaluate the working systems and we are all visibly aligned because we can see what's happening. This is what is transparency, and this is something that I love in SAFe. Many organizations, remember when I was a manager in a waterfall, the whole MPP file was in my laptop. To be honest, I've screwed up the laptop. I've screwed up my MPP file number of times. Why? Just to make your CPI and SPI 100%. The cost performance index and the schedule performance index, we never care for value delivery. We were only worried about making these two metrics 100%. So let me move. The next important part I want to focus is on the leadership. Leadership is the foundational element of SAFe House of Lean. Leaders have to lead the change. Leaders cannot delegate change. Delegation of this of the safe transformation will make sure that it's going to fall apart. The transformation will fall apart. Leaders should create a learning culture in the organization. They have to learn. They have to enable people to learn. Remember, guys, learning is the only way we have survived so far. Otherwise, the human race would have been extinct long time back. Develop people. People are the most important assets. And if we do not invest on our people, people will go to some other place where they feel that they are invested there. We need to protect our people. We need to invest and need to develop our people. Inspiration. Leader's fundamental job is to inspire people. As a comedy note, I always say that if leaders do not inspire, organizations expire. Alignment with organization missions. Leaders have to talk in such a way that it draws complete alignment. There has to be a clear alignment. Everybody knows what the vision and mission statement of the organization is. And in order to have this kind of an alignment, you need to decentralize decision making. Everything the leader cannot do. You need to trust your people and give it to them and let them do the job. Finally, unlock intrinsic motivation of knowledge workers. We are not a kind of people working in factory doing the same job every day. For us, every day is a new job. So our motivation skills, our motivational needs are very different from what we saw in factory systems. If you try to give bonus as a motivational element, it works only for a short duration of time. Afterwards, people don't care for bonus. So we will have to learn how to unlock the intrinsic motivation of workers. Finally, what are the role of leaders now? During our waterfall model, the executives would set the vision. The senior leaders would produce answer and they would direct masses. People like developers, testers were getting directions from senior project managers and they were just blindly doing what the manager said. This model is extinct, right? It has to be destroyed. We need to create a model where the executives still set the session, whereas the senior leadership provide coaching and then every developer and tester find solutions which is aligned to the mission. This is the only model that works in the coming days. If organizations still continue the left side, left part of it, very soon you will see their names being removed from the system. One of my favorite examples of an organization that shows the right side behavior is none other than our army. The Indian Army does exactly this. The leaders provide coaching and the soldiers go execute with what mission statement they have given. There is nobody giving instructions to people. It's moved away from instruction-based management to intent-based management. I'm not really sure if we want these kind of leaders to lead the world. Or maybe that's the next slide. So what is the leader's challenge? The leader's challenge is depicted in this picture. See, look at the leader at the top. Not only the leader has to move on the top of the cliff, the leader has to pull people so that they also come forward along with the leader. A leader's main job is to create value in terms of customer, in terms of people. Not only you have to be a leader, you have to create new leaders. And it is not possible if you do not turn back, understand the challenges of your juniors, and then pull them with the same rope that you are also trying to climb. This is by far the most important aspect of leadership in today's world. Remember, we are doing a complex job and it requires enormous leadership instincts to do this. But I'm not sure what kind of leaders we have today. Most of the time, I see leaders like this. Leaders should lead from the front, not like this. I hope you understand this picture, right? Okay, let's quickly move. I want to touch a little bit about SAFe and DevOps. As I told you, DevOps is probably the next generation of software industry. It's revolutionizing the way how we see software development and software releases to the customer. Now, what does SAFe do? SAFe creates a bridge between what is Agile and what is DevOps. How does it do? Because in SAFe, a train does these four important things. One is, we continuously explore the customer needs. We continuously integrate and develop our hypothesis or our assumptions. and then we continuously deploy to production to validate our hypothesis, and we always release software when the customers need. This is what is the heart of DevOps, in making sure that we do DevOps. And we call this as the continuous delivery pipeline, because all what you're doing within your PIs fall under these boundaries. And the beauty here is we have decoupled deployment to release. What is deployment and release? Deploying is you deploy the code to production, but it is not released to your customers. It is released to customers only when it is needed. For example, look at the, you'll in another couple of months, you'll probably be getting something called as the great Indian Diwali sale in Amazon. Do you think that they are going to deploy the code one day before the Diwali sale starts? No way. It would have been done 1 month before the release, before the start of the Diwali sale. And it will be tested in production by a lot of people and a lot of automated tools. That's what is the beauty of decoupling deployment and release. And on the day one, on the night, 12 o'clock, all the new features of the sale are enabled to the whole public. So how does SAFe implement DevOps? SAFe has a beautiful model called as the CALMR model. C stands for a culture where everybody takes responsibility of development, deployment, and operations. A is automation. If you do not have automation, you can't even spill DevOps. Automation is the heart of DevOps. And there's something called lean flow. Lean flow is a concept of how quickly we can stuff production, how quickly we can push stuff to production and get feedback and make sure that we don't block work. It's a continuous flow of value. Next is measurement. You will have to measure everything. There is something called as full stack telemetry. You will have to understand what is happening in the database. You will have to measure what's happening in the middle tier. You will have to understand what's happening in the front tier, and you learn to understand what's happening from a business value standpoint. Everything has to be constantly measured, and improvement has to be done. Constant improvement creates a great DevOps culture. And finally, recovery. Not only pushing code to production is important. If something goes wrong, you have to recover back to the original stable state is also equally important. So it could be either rollback or fix forward. You fix the problem and make sure that you move, or if the feedback of the defect is so bad, you kind of roll it back. Essentially, if you can ensure that these five things are done properly, we are in fact a DevOps organization. That's how SAFe has put DevOps, and every bullet here, I would say, is a book by itself. You really cannot say, by reading these six lines, we understood DevOps. Every bullet here is an epic by itself. How do we implement SAFe in organizations then? This is exactly what we teach in SPC class. In our implementing SAFe class, this is what is being taught. And I really do not have time to go through all the parts, but the most important part is called as the tipping point. Tipping point is a point where the organization realizes, okay, time has come for us to do something different. We really cannot continue to do waterfall in this era. Time has come. This is exactly what happens with most of the change systems that will happen. If you go and see the revolutions that have happened in photography industry or in medical industry or in insurance industry, every change has to hit a tipping point. Similarly, every enterprise will have to face this tipping point. And once you do tipping point, I just want to talk about the two next important steps. First is we create SPCs in the organization. Look at the importance of becoming an SPC. This is the first step in the transformation journey. We will have to create SPCs in the organization, and then you have to train leaders and executives. Most of the time, this doesn't happen. And if that step three doesn't happen, it is clearly understood that your SAFe implementation is getting into a disaster. It's going to hit a rough weather very quickly. So the next step is the third step, which is the most important step, is training leaders and executives. And this has to be done by SPCs who get trained in step two. So training of SPCs, becoming SPCs, is not a joke. It's a very, very important role in the organization. And the remaining steps, what is there as a part of implementation, is the part of your SPC class. Day 3, day 4 is exactly what we teach. lot of exercises, a lot of examples, and that's how you can become an SPC who get a blueprint of how you would transform your existing old structures into the safe enterprise. What are the challenges that we see in safe transformation? At least these are the top 12 challenges that I have seen. First is leadership buy-in. If you don't have leadership support, if your leaders have not bought in the safe transformation and they say that safe doesn't work for us, even once in any conversation, that's it. The transformation is going to fall apart. The second one is the leadership belief in the safe way of working. See, belief is very important. To give you a simple example of what beliefs and how beliefs change our behavior, imagine a person who goes to a temple who doesn't believe in God, and imagine a person who goes to a temple who believes in God. Do you see the change in behavior of those two guys? That is exactly what happens in organizations when the leaders do not believe in safe. Their behaviors will be completely erratic. They will talk a language that will demotivate the whole system. So leadership belief is very important. So as SPCs, it is our job to make sure that we instill the belief system. We need to shake their conventional belief system, shake their whole body as such, and say that, look, we have got a new way. Let's embrace it. Organization silo mentality. Organizations are split into pieces, and this is not going to take us anywhere. Respect for people and culture. Safe is for enterprise ability, and most organizations are now distributed. So if you do not have respect for people culture, I think it's gone. Fast fail culture. This is something very, very important to understand. Most of the organizations here come and say that we can't fail. But remember, innovation doesn't happen without failing. But let's not fail too late in the game. Let's fail very much fast in the game so that we can recover back. Set-based engineering culture. We always go with one solution, and that solution often is something that doesn't work. So we've got a beautiful system, say, approach called a set-based engineering in Lean. We have to use it. The whole of transformation is about deliberate learning versus deliberate practice. Deliberate learning puts you into uncomfortable zone. Patience and perseverance is extremely important. Rome was not built in a day. Neither Bangalore was not built in a day, nor India was not built in a day. It takes a lot of time to change the culture. Getting the right team members is very, very important, because every line of code what you write actually enhances agility. So getting the right team competency is important. You need to understand, accept, and live the DevOps culture now. And that's exactly what SAFE enables. Remember, we are developing in an innovation culture. We are not doing control C, control V, or control X, control V now. We are trying to create an idea from some thoughts that have come. We are giving life to a new product. So it requires enormous amount of failure, patience, testing, hypothesis. And that's something that we've not done. And finally, rewards and recognition. It's totally different in the way how we are seeing now. On one side, we talk about team recognition, but when you reward team recognition, individuals will quit and go. If you try to do individual recognition, motivations will come. So we really don't know how to reward and recognize people in the agile way of working. So these are some top 12 challenges that I've seen in the transformation. Agile contracts and budgets are more related to the way how you see as projects, whereas SAFE asks us to come out of this project culture. SAFE says stop projects, start focusing on flow of value. See, any project always has a start and an end. That's the definition of a project. But if you go with a project, it generally people talk about story points based projects. So you deliver so many story points, you give this. And I've seen horror stories in the organization whenever people do this. First of all, we can't equate story point to hours. One story point equal to 8 hours is a statement that doesn't get a bail in the Indian Penal Code. No, that is absolutely wrong. But people do it. People tag 8 hours to a story point and then they do it. They're doing all. So story point estimation is wrong. Remember, we are in a complex world where we are trying to do experiments to unearth the real requirements of the user. When you really don't know real requirements, how can you get into fixed-based kind of projects? So this has always been a challenge to organization who has been contracting. They don't know how to contract. When everything is known, when requirements are fixed, the designs are fixed, let's get into a contracting to see how much time it takes to develop. That's a different paradigm altogether. Here, you have to engage with the teams to understand what the real need is. So it's very difficult. Can you share some about architectural runway and solution intent? Very simple, guys. What is solution context? Solution context is the environment in which your solution you're trying to build. For example, let's assume that you are building a Practo. Practo is a mobile application that helps you to build, that helps you to get appointments with various doctors who have registered with the Practo application. The Practo application comes in two different models. One is a mobile application, one is a website. You have to develop both the applications in very different way. The technical capabilities of your mobile application, technical capabilities of your website are slightly different. Well, the user interface are very different. The way how you navigate your screens are different. Well, solution objective is same. Objective is what? Help people to register for their doctors, appointments with their doctors. But the way how you develop this, the way how you test your mobile app is very different from the way how you do this. The deployment also changes. So that is what is solution context. What's architecture runway? How often have we all integrated our website with payment gateway? How many times we have done it? We never do this. But now there is a requirement for us to integrate our website into payment gateway. Who will do this? Who will do this? The team has to do this. But the team has never done this. Now how can you give commitment? So architecture runway is the architecture that you build, the enablers that you do in your various APIs and iterations, which will create platform for the next set of features to work on. So you create multiple POCs to prove that this architecture actually works for us. That is what is called architecture runway. Did you ever encounter a situation where we had diversified business owners DRPI planning to provide business? Oh yes, we have had horror stories here. We have had a lot of problems with various business owners. The business owners come and tell you that this particular enabler has no value. Give it one rating for it. But your system architect will come and tell, if I don't do this enabler, your next features will not come into existence. So there is clashes between the way how the business owners, the marketing guys and the technical guys really work. So we created a very simple rule. Objectives written for marketing features, the business owners from marketing will give business value. Objectives written for the enablers, the system architect would give. Many a times the business owners are not happy with the objectives what the team writes. They say that the objectives are incomplete. They want a typical Shakespeare based English language to be written by objectives. No, that's not is the intent. The intent of writing objectives is very different. We don't want to create software. Creating software will not help us. We need to create business impact. The fact that you always reiterate saying that the business, the moving away from outputs to outcomes is the essence of writing business objectives. That needs a little bit of an education. But once people realize it, it becomes a very nice way of working. When is safe not suitable for an organization? How do you decide the way safe is the way or Scrum? Okay. Let's assume that there is a startup company. Startup company has two teams. The product owner is for the team is located in India and everybody are sitting in India. Don't do safe. Why? Safe is for enterprise. Your whole product management is one product owner. Scrum is more than enough. But when you are trying to build complex projects, if you're trying to build an aircraft, you need aeronautical engineers. You need electrical engineers. You need mechanical engineers. You need design engineers. You need safety engineers. You need regulation engineers. When everybody are required, when you're trying to build a complex system and you need to build it real fast, that's when safe is an excellent tool to deal with multi-engineering aspects. That's when safe becomes effective. Now, how do you know whether safe can work or not? Well, How do you know if the medicine will work or not? Take the medicine for a couple of days. See if you are okay. Complete the course. You are back to normal. If not, go back. Do one more test. See what changes have to be done. That's the same way we have to start here. So do small experiments in such a way that your failure is sustainable. A failure should be sustainable. Fail fast. Do small experiments. And then once you are convinced that safe works, then take it with a grand scale. That's exactly how most of the organizations do. Don't think all the organization will start from portfolio. Never. They never start from portfolio. They will always start from the what is called as essential safe. The bare minimum what needs to be done in order for a train. They start with that and then slowly scale up across. And that's exactly what we teach in safe in the SPC class. How do we scale? What should be started first? How do you know whether it is successful or not? How do you take it to the next step? These are some aspects we talk in the implementing safe part of it. Development cadence. We have 3 minutes. I'll try to quickly give you an answer. If you see your army folks walking, 20 of them are walking in 5 rows. Each row has 5. You feel as if all of them are walking as a one unit. That is what is cadence. Cadence is your rhythm or your discipline. So what cadence does is, it says all teams will have only 2-week iterations. So if there is one team that is producing an API and there is one team that needs to consume an API, the team, the producer says, I will do it in iteration 1. The consumer says, I will integrate in iteration 2. So this is what is called cadence. Now, if you have one team works on 2 weeks, the other team works on 5 weeks, the other team works on 3 weeks iteration, it is not possible for you to quickly integrate work. And if you cannot integrate quickly, you are doing a disaster. So that is what is called development cadence. Cadence makes wait times predictable. Something like simple as, I don't know what I will deliver in 2 weeks, but I will definitely deliver something in 2 weeks. Before PI planning, you can start with this language. And then during PI planning, you will tell what you can deliver. So everybody in the system knows that at the end of 2 weeks, something will come. So planning is easy. You can synchronize your work and produce a system increment. That's what is cadence all about. So I find a challenge to convince my customers that they need for an IP iteration. Could you share challenges? Oh, yes. When I was doing a training in one of the services company, literally the training was stopped when I came to IP iteration. They said, sorry, it will not happen. Look, as SPC coaches, we will have to learn multiple ways of doing it. You'll have to start talking about various, you have to search in the internet about various companies who give time for innovation. And innovation cannot happen if you are continuously working. Just imagine if you take a brand new Maruti car from Kanyakumari and to drive up to Ladakh non-stop, your car will only make Ladakh noise, that's all. Nothing else will work in the car after some time. You need to give break. You need to refuel, you need to service it, you need to do some checks and then move forward. We are not in a world where everything is known. We are in an uncertain world where nothing is known. When nothing is known, you cannot run fast. You have to stop to make a checkpoint of where you are. And this checkpoint is your IP iteration. So loading a product development process 100% is an economic disaster. This is what Don Brennerstern tells in his book. And it is very true. Just imagine if you guys work for 24 hours for 4 days, do you think you'll come to office on Friday? No way. You cannot come. Your body will not allow you to get up. So that's the challenge. That's how you need to deal with them. I think we are at the end of the time. If you have any questions, you can always post it to KnowledgeHut and we can always talk about things. Thank you for your time and I hope you're all benefited from this. And I generally am available in a lot of meetups. So if there are any questions, you can always post it and then we can always learn from each other.